Yes, of course.
Okay.
So I will talk also about the first passage percolation, but I will talk about the other interpretation of first passage percolation, one other interpretation, which is more studied. So I guess a lot of you already know them, already know this interpretation, but I will start from scratch. So you do not need to know anything about first passage percolation. And so I will talk about a joint work with Jean-Baptiste Guéret. He's in Tours in France. So we want to study a continuous model of first passage percolation, but to understand why we are looking at this, I think it's important to talk about classical model of first passage percolation on ZD. So I start with a standard model of first passage percolation. And of course, I start with the definition of the model. So Barbara already talked about first passage percolation, but my interpretation will be different. So I consider the graph ZD with vertices ZD and the edges between nearest neighbors. For dimension D bigger than 2. So for instance, for D equal to 2, you just have the square lattice. And I associate with the edges a family of IID random variable, which are non-negative, but I do not interpret these variables in the same way as Barbara, since I consider that T of E is the time needed to cross the edge E. So I will denote by F the distribution of my random variables. So T of E is the time needed to cross E. So this is a model for a propagation phenomenon. Which has been introduced by Hammersley and Welsh back in the 60s. And this interpretation of T of E is in fact the first one that has been studied. So if you interpret T of E as the time needed to cross E, you obtain a random pseudometric. Big T of x, y for 2 points, x and y in ZD, as the infimum of the time needed to travel along a path gamma, which goes from x to y, where, so this T of gamma is just defined as the sum of T of E for any ages E in gamma. So you just travel along a path and it takes you some time. And at the end, if you want to go from a point to another one, you just choose the fastest way to go from X to Y. So this T of XY, it is symmetric. This is just because I do not consider oriented edges. So the time needed to cross an edge is the same to go in one side or the other one, and a path from X to Y can obviously seen as a path from Y to X, so no problem. You also have the triangular inequality. Because if you want to go from X to Z, an option is to pass through Y. So you can consider a path from X to Y, a path from Y to Z, and concatenate this path to obtain a path from X to Z. So if you optimize this, you obtain that the time needed to go from X to Z is smaller than the sum, than the following sum. But what you do not have is that if T of XY is null, this does not imply that X is equal to Y, because it is possible that the time needed to cross an edge is null. Okay, but except this, what you obtain is indeed a metric. And it has been widely studied. This model has been widely studied. And what you obtain is the definition of the time constant, which is the equivalent of the flow constant that Barbara was talking about in this interpretation of the model. So the key ingredient in the study of first passage percolation is subadditivity. So I guess a lot of you already know subadditivity, but for those who don't, I will just say a few words about it. So consider you have two different scales, big N and small n, and for simplicity, suppose that big N is equal to NP, and you want to go from zero to a very far away point, big N, the one. The one is just the first vector, 1, 0, 0, 0. So this is the point of coordinates n, 0, 0, 0, 0. So to go from 0 to n, 1, you can stop at small n, 1, 2, n, 1, and so on. And by the triangular inequality, what you obtain is that the time you need to go from zero to big N E1 is smaller than the sum of the times you need to go from one point to the next one along this path. So from E minus one, small N E1 to E N one. So this is just a triangular inequality. So now I add a second ingredient, which is some assumption of integrability. So I make a moment assumption here. So I can take the expectation of the previous inequality to obtain that the expectation of the time to go from zero to big N E1 is smaller than the sum. And the third ingredient is just the translation invariance of the model. If you make a translation with integer coordinate, what you see is exactly the same. So thanks to this translation invariance, you get that all these expectations are equal to the expectation of the time to go from zero to small n, one. So if you divide everything by big N, you obtain this. This is equal to one over small n. You let big N go to infinity, then small n go to infinity, and you obtain that the limf is smaller than the limsum, so the limit exists. In fact, it is equal to the infimum. And you can give it a name. It will be what I will call mu. So this is really not hard. It is a bad proof of Fekete's lemma. In fact, as soon as I took the expectation, nothing is random anymore. But subadditivity is a lot more strong because it allows to obtain almost sure convergence of the random variables. So by ergodic subadditive theorem that Hammersley and Welsh already obtained, but this kind of theorem was improved by Kingman. You know that under some moment assumption, for instance, you can just suppose that the expectation of T of E is finite. Then this time, properly rescaled, converges almost surely and in L1 to mu. So, so what is this mu? Mu is what we call the time constant. And in fact, 1 over mu is something like the average asymptotic speed of propagation in the direction of E1. So this time constant is the object we want to study. And we can wonder what is the dependence of this time constant. So obviously, mu depends on several things. Of course, it depends on the dimension. Okay. But I will consider that the dimension is fixed. Mu also depends on the direction because my model is not isotropic. So in fact, you can define a time constant in any direction.
Right, the directions that are along the axes have to be the same, right?
Because yes,
the same geometry.
Okay. Yes, of course, you're right. Any transformation of ZD that lets ZD invariant will let the mu invariant also. So you can define a mu of V that depends on the direction V. And in fact, the convergence is uniform. In any direction, if your moment assumption is strong enough, this is equivalent to what we call the shape theorem. You can look at how the propagation holds in any direction at the same time. And the third dependence is on F, which is a distribution. Of the random passage times associated with the edges. So
yeah, sorry for an interruption. Just if you're taking an irrational direction, then you can only work with approximations to that direction, right? I mean, you have to.
Okay, if you want to apply subadditive ergodic theorem, you have to look at rational direction. But then by homogeneity, you can define mu on Rd. And then if your moment assumption is strong enough, you can prove that in this direction, you also have convergence to this mu that you have defined by continuity.
Okay.
So is there any other question? Feel free to ask. That's okay. So the dependence that interests me is the dependence in the distribution in F. So I see mu as in fact a function of F. And what we know about mu as a function of F, the first thing we know, and it is linked with a question that were asked to Barbara before. We know when mu is null. We know that mu is strictly positive in if and only if the atom of the distribution at zero is small enough. So this is a probability that the passage time of an edge is null. It has to be smaller, strictly smaller than PC of D, where PC of D is the critical parameter. Of an IID bound percolation. On ZD. In other words, mu of E is strictly positive if and only if the percolation with the edges that have null passage time is subcritical. Okay, so one interesting fact is that except when mu is null and when the distribution is trivial, there are not a single distribution function for which we can calculate mu. So actually I presented you the only case where we know the value of mu. There are a lot of results about the behavior of mu. For instance, Régine Marchand proved that if you have two distributions that are one dominates the other one strictly, then you can compare the time constant. So I don't give details here, but what interests me is the following property that says that the function that associates with F, the time constant mu of F, is continuous. So here I equip the set of distribution with the topology of weak convergence. In other words, if Fn converges weakly to F, then mu of Fn converges to mu of F. So this result has some kind of history. The first proof of it goes back to Cox in the 80s. So for D equal to 2. And he made the following hypothesis. So he considered a sequence Fn that was converges to F. And he supposed that he had some stochastic domination by a distribution G that was integrable. And then the result was improved by Cox Kesten, still in dimension two, but with a no domination assumption. Then by Kesten in any dimension. And then by Olivier Garret, Régine Marchand, Eviatar, and myself. In the case where the distribution can also put an atom at the infinite. Sorry. So why do I give you this biblio? Because I want to show you that the difficulty in this proof is linked with the tail distribution, the tail of the distribution F. The difficulty is to take care of what happens when your distributions are not do not have a compact support and have maybe a heavy tail. So if you have a distribution with the same compact support, then you have a very easy proof, a one-page long proof. Of this convergence, and this proof uses a well-known control on the length of a geodesic, but there is no added difficulty in the proof. So the problems come with the tail of the distributions. Sorry, I lose my... In particular, the key lemma of the proof is the following. If Fm is a distribution of T of E inf M, then prove that the time constant associated with Fm converges to the time constant associated to F when M goes to infinity. So I guess this lemma shows you that indeed the tail is a problem. Do you have any question on this?
I didn't understand what the last line was. What is Fm is the distribution of?
Oh,
what?
Sorry. This is the infimum of T of E and M.
Okay.
I just cut the tail and see what I obtain. And in fact, if you cut at a higher and higher level, you will recover your time constant. Any question? Any other question? So let's move to a continuous model of first passage percolation. So standard first passage percolation on ZD can be seen as a generalization of percolation, where you put non-negative random variables on the edges instead of a 0-1 variable. So to define a continuous model of first passage percolation, it is natural to start from a continuous model of percolation. And the obvious model you can consider is a Boolean model. So I start with a Boolean model, which can be defined as follows informally. I threw point in RD. So I take key, a Poisson point process. On RD with intensity lambda times the Lebesgue measure. And to each point X of key, I associate a random variable R of X such that I obtain IID non-negative random variables. So I denote by big R a random variable which has the same distribution as my R of X. And those R of X are the radii of balls that I center at each point. So around X, I put a ball of radius R of X. And I just consider the union of all these balls. So sigma is the union of all the balls . So in fact, this is not really the good way to define it. More formally, you have to take a Poisson point process on RD times R plus at the same time. And so you take the Poisson point process of intensity lambda dx times the distribution of my random variable R. I can rewrite it as dx times nu, where nu is lambda times the distribution of R. And sigma is the union of the balls B of XR, where XR is in my Poisson point process. So I just threw balls in the space. Those balls have a random radius. And if I want to define a first passage percolation model on it, I have several ways to do it, but one easy way to do is to say that a particle travels at different speed inside sigma and outside sigma. So I choose two different speeds. I say that it travels at speed one outside sigma and at speed infinite inside sigma. And this allows me to define a random pseudometric on RD. So for gamma, a polygonal path from a point A to a point B in RD, I can define the passage time of gamma, the time needed to cross gamma, in the following way. So I take my gamma. I can make appear the set sigma. So I travel at infinite speed inside sigma and at speed one outside. So I just have to take time to go through the green path of gamma, and the time I need to travel along this green path is just the Euclidean length of the path. So the time needed to travel along gamma is just the Euclidean length of the green part of gamma, which is in fact gamma outside sigma. And so the time needed to go from A to B is just the infimum of these times of travel along path. Is it okay for you? So this is one possible continuous generalization of the first passage percolation model.
Over here, any 2 points inside sigma are zero distance, yes?
If sigma percolates, yes.
If it's connected, yeah.
Yeah, if sigma does not percolate, it depends if you are in the same connected component. In fact, even if sigma percolates, what you say is true only in the infinite, in the non-bounded component of sigma. But yes, if you take A and B in the same connected component of sigma, then the time to travel from A to B is null. Exactly. So once you have defined this pseudometric T, of course, you can also define a time constant exactly in the same way. You have the same subadditive arguments. And in fact, activity, I can write it. Okay. In fact, you have no moment assumption to make because the times you need to go from A to B is always smaller than the time you need to travel along the straight path between A and B. And this time is smaller than the Euclidean length of the segment AB. So this is smaller than this quantity. So no moment assumption is needed because all your passage time are bounded, so they are integrable. So by subadditivity.
This system also doesn't seem to be direction dependent, right? I mean, it's just the,
exactly.
Just the distance.
Yes, because you have an isotropic model this time. So you defined a time constant, I denoted by mu again. This time constant depends on the dimension and on this mu, which is the intensity lambda of the process of the center times the law, the distribution of the ready. But it does not depend on the direction this time because of the isotropy of the model. And this mu is the limit of the time you need to go from zero to x divided by the Euclidean norm of x when this Euclidean norm goes to infinity. So here I what I state say that the convergence is indeed uniform in the direction, and so I just write it once. What you obtain is a constant that does not depend on the direction because of the isotropy of the model. So this is one of the interest of this model. You obtain something that is isotropic. So in a sense, it is easier for this reason, but for other reasons, it will be harder to study. Is it okay for everyone? So this is really trivial. Now, what we know about mu. In fact, we have the first assumption to make on our Boolean model to ensure that this model is not degenerated, because if the expectation of R to the D is infinite, then the Boolean model is equal to RD, almost surely. So in this case, the balls are covering RD itself. And so the pseudometric T is just equal to zero. And you do not have anything to study. It is not really interesting. So the minimal assumption we will make is that the expectation of a radius to the power d is finite, which is equivalent to saying that the integral of rd nu dr is finite. Otherwise, there is nothing to study. What do we know about mu? Not a lot of things, but we can recover the equivalent of Kesten's theorem that was studying when mu is null. So this is a result we obtained with Jean-Baptiste previously. We know that under a stronger assumption, this is assumption H1, and I will define an assumption H2, which is that the following integral is finite. I will come back to this assumption in just 1 minute. So under this assumption, we know that mu is strictly positive if and only if the Boolean model is subcritical in the following sense: the probability that you are able to cross an annulus of radius r by staying inside sigma is going to zero when r goes to infinity. So in other words, mu is strictly positive if and only if the Boolean model sigma is strongly, I will say, subcritical. So this is really the equivalent of Kesten's theorem that was saying that the time constant in a standard first passage percolation on ZD add a strictly positive time constant if and only if the percolation of ages of null passage time was subcritical. This is exactly the same setting. So a remark on the assumption: H2 is a bit stronger than H1, but not a lot. Because if you have a positive epsilon such that you have a moment d plus epsilon, then you recover H2. So H2 is not exactly what we would like to obtain. We would like to have just a moment d, but we need a little bit more. And actually, we have no idea what is happening between H2 and H1. We were not able to study this case, but it is a small case. The difference between H2 and H1 is not that that wide. So where does this H2 comes from? It comes from the study of greedy lattice animals. And greedy paths. And it comes from a study of by James Martin. I don't remember the year. I'm sorry about that. I think it was, no, I'm not sure of it. So so this H2 appeared on a paper by Martin. And this is because we use some greedy paths, greedy lattice animals, to prove our result. This is the reason why we need this age to hypothesis. So this is one thing we know about mu. And of course, the next natural question we can ask is the continuity of mu. Is mu continuous with regards to the law of the underlying Boolean model, which means the parameter lambda, which is the intensity of the center of the balls, and the law, the distribution of the radii? And the answer is yes. This is what we proved with Jean-Baptiste. I will give you not the stronger version of the result, but a version that does not need too much definition to be stated. So if you have a sequence of random radii that converges, sequence of distribution that converges to a limit distribution, you have a sequence of intensities lambda n that converges to a limit lambda infinite. And you make the following assumption that for any n, including infinite, Rn is stochastically dominated by some hat hair, which is satisfying H2. Then the time constant associated with lambda n and the distribution of Rn is converging to the time constant associated with lambda infinite and the distribution of R infinite. Okay, so this is not really a surprise. I mean, of course, we were expecting this continuity of the time constant. It is, of course, an analog of what is happening in the classical model of first passage percolation. But there is a huge difference in the nature of the hypothesis we are making here, because we require a domination assumption, but this domination has nothing to do with the one that Cox was making at the beginning of the study of the continuity of mu in the classical first passage percolation. Indeed, remember that the pseudometric T is very well controlled. So there is no zone in RD with a high passage time. This is because of our choice of speed. We choose speed one or speed infinite inside or outside sigma. So we do not choose very, very low speed. And this means that we do not allow very high passage times between points. So there is no integrability problem at all in this model. Here we need an assumption on the law of the radii. It means that we have problems with big balls. Big balls in our Boolean model does not correspond to zones where you have high passage times. In fact, it precisely corresponds to zones where you have null passage times. because the speed is infinite inside sigma. So the problem is really of a different nature. And this problem we have with big balls is linked to the fact that it induces long range correlation in the model. Remember for classical first passage speculation, I said, okay, if all your distribution were supported by the same compact, you have a one page long proof. Here, if the radii are bounded by the same constant, you also have a very shorter proof. And problem arises when you have this long range correlations because of the big balls. So when Rn and R infinite are not bounded. So in the 3 minutes I have left, I will just give elements of proof. So take two different measures. So nu one is lambda one times the distribution of a random variable R1. Nu two is lambda two distribution of R2, such that nu one is stochastically dominated by nu two. Then you can make a coupling such that the two processes that are driving the Boolean models share the same set of centers. Let call it key. Sorry, key is included in RD. And then for any point in this process key, you can associate two random variables, R1 and R2. So this is the radius for the process indexed by two, and this is the radius for the process indexed by one, and it can be null. It corresponds to the fact that you can have a ball for the second process, but not for the first one, and it means that the radius is null. So if you do this, you obtain two Boolean models that are such that sigma one is included in sigma two. Thus, it is obvious that the time for the first one is bigger than the time for the second one. And so the time constant associated with the first one is bigger than the time constant associated with the second one. So it is really easy to compare them. So you have to look at what happens conversely. So let P be a nice geodesic from the origin to the boundary of a ball of radius S for the time T2. When I say nice, I imply that this geodesic can change direction only at centers of balls, so only at points in key. So if I represent the two Boolean models, I will have balls here for sigma 1. Some of them are just reduced to nothing. And I will have bigger balls for sigma 2. Or maybe I will have balls where there were no ball at all for sigma 1. So along P, the difference of time you need to walk along P between the two processes can be controlled by the following term. So if I look at T1 of the time needed to go outside this ball, this is smaller than T1 of P, which is smaller than T2 of P, plus the sum of the two times the sum of the difference of the radii for the two processes along the points of my process that belong to P. T2 of P is equal to T2 of 0 P 0 S complement. And so what I obtain is that when I divide this by S, I have the following control, and I will add some intermediate step by adding here the length, the Euclidean length of P. So delta R of X is just this quantity. This is the difference between the radii. So I have this. So these terms converges when S go to infinity towards mu 1. This term converges when S go to infinity towards mu 2. And so I have to control these two terms. The first one is in fact a control on the length of a geodesic. And this will be controlled by an adaptation of BK argument. And this control of the length of a geodesic already appeared in the study of classical first passage percolation. And that term can be seen as the reward gained by P if you have a reward of delta R of X at each point X. And so this is controlled by greedy lattice animal arguments. Okay, so I will stop now because my time is over. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions? So I have one. So you showed us the continuity when you fix the intensity, fix lambda and change the distribution of the radii, right? What about the converse if I, or was this both together already?
You can do both together. Okay. You can do both together. And in fact, in fact, to have a statement which is a bit more robust to deal with both the intensity and the radii distribution at the same time. And we can control the difference between, in my sketch of proof, between mu 1 and mu 2 in terms of an integral on the distribution, the new associated with the difference between the two set of measures. But yes, in fact, if you want to study only the continuity in lambda, you have simpler proofs. And this is what we wanted to do at the first side. And and then we realized that the proof could not deal with the ready, so we had to start again. And so it is really harder to study the continuity with regard to the distribution of the ready, but you can insert the continuity with regard to lambda free in the proof.
So you cannot get something about continuity in lambda with a weaker assumption about the distribution of the ready, something like this?
No, we could not, but this should be possible. Of course, I mean, there is no reason to believe that H2 is needed. Mm-hmm. It has a technical use because we need this greedy pass argument to take care of this long range dependence. Mm-hmm. And this is an open question when studying greedy lattice animals and greedy pass to obtain weaker moment assumption.
Okay, thanks. Are there any other questions? If not, let's thank both speakers of today. Excellent talks. And see you all next week.
Thank you and goodbye.
So, Marie?
Oui.
Just a second. So let me stop the recording.